have to go to Gangneung and Sydney for taking good care of me for home hospitality. I arrived Sunday. Yesterday, I took a full day off and did a bit of a touring. I went to Inter-Murus place, paid a visit to Fort Santiago, and I got to know the heroic stories of Jose Rizal. That was very moving. And then we went to St. Augustine Cathedral, spent a couple of hours there. They had a great collection. That was very impressive. After which we went to Rizal Park, and then we went to Harbor Place to see the sunset. That was quite impressive. And it was really great to touch base with my former student, Mark Isla, there. I met him the day before yesterday, right? Sunday, and we went to Bonifacio Business District
together.
Yeah. There's a lot of rivalry between Bonifacio and Aguinaldo. I was asked to discuss, to assess the implications of the Bakunin impeachment and the inauguration of the Moon Jae-in government for the Korea's democracy, and also the implication of Moon Jae-in's foreign policy. Some of the major foreign policy challenges that the Moon Jae-in government is faced with, and also a transformation of U.S.-Korea. South Korea, U.S. Alliance partnership under the new Moon Jae-in government. So here it is, the impeachment and the new government, and what it means to Korea's democracy and the foreign policy challenges that the Moon Jae-in government is faced with. But I must say upfront that I am not really confident about the first part, although I am very comfortable about talking about the second part of my lecture, because as I was introduced, I am an international relations scholar, and my expertise lies in U.S. foreign policy, U.S. foreign policy for Northeast Asia, for the Korean Peninsula, inter-Korean relations, Korean unification issues, North Korean nuclear and missile defense programs. And those are my areas of expertise, if you will. So I'm not really confident about the first part, you know, the impeachment and inauguration of the new government, what it means to the Korean democracy. But I did a bit of research myself, so let's get to the first part here of the impeachment of Park Geun-hye and the inauguration of the Moon Jae-in government and what it means for the Korean democracy. There is still debate going on in Korea and in the world, in academia as well. Some people say that the impeachment of Park Geun-hye dealt a significant blow to Korea's democracy. The way Park Geun-hye governed Korea and the way she was involved in this very mysterious scandal was a big disgrace on the part of many Koreans. So as a whole, Park Geun-hye's impeachment tarnished Korea's national image as a democratic country. And some people go as far as to argue that this incident proves that Korea isn't really a mature democracy. Rather, Korea is what they call autocracy. It's a rule by the mass, ruled by ignored mass. Why? Because it was the mass. It was the regular people who took the matters into their own hands and out to the street, waging this massive demonstration that ultimately brought down the government of Park Geun-hye. So it wasn't really rule of the law. Rather, it was ruled by the mass. Ignore the mass. And there was Michael Green, an English journalist, and also Junie Hong, American journalist working for CNN, they argued along this line. It was a big phrase. Michael Green, this article to foreign policy, in Korea, democracy, in Korean democracy, the people are a wrathful God. And Junie Hong, in this article, titled "The President Got Impeached for Being Embarrassing," I got actually a quotation from Junie Hong's. Article for CNN here. Quote, I have no great love for Park Geun-hye, but it is hard not to notice that our impeachment is pretty much based on the Korean people's very feelings. She's possibly the first president of any democratic nation to be formally impeached for being embarrassing, for being stupid, and for being in disgrace. And not for hard evidence of graft, corruption, or perjury. And as a matter of fact, at the time of impeachment, there wasn't really a known smoking gun in support of his bribery charge against Park Geun-hye. Prosecutors have yet to present hard evidence in support of this bribery charge against Park Geun-hye. And as a matter of fact, the bribery trial is still in process. So this proves that Korea, in Korean democracy, rule of law doesn't prevail. It is the rule of the mass that prevails in Korean governance or but it seems that there are more people who are saying that the incident was a big boost for the Korean democracy. Why? Because the incident actually empowered people's power in Korean democracy. And as that's the way it should be in the world democracy, the people should prevail. I mean, that's the essence of liberal democracy. So what happened in Korea was really popular sovereignty in action. Popular sovereignty in action. And this journalist, I had a bit of difficulty pronouncing this guy's name, Ishan Tharoor, who's also a renowned journalist working for Washington Post, in this article, how South Korea just showed the world how to do democracy. This guy is actually praising the credentials of South Korea's democracy. Quote, at a time when there is so much hand-wringing over the crisis of liberal democracy and the rise of overseas nationalism in the West, South Korea just offered a welcome reminder that people power is still very much alive. So this incident was the incident that enhanced the accountability of the government. In liberal democracy, the people power to hold the government, hold your government accountable, hold your government responsible. That's what exactly what happened in South Korea. The South Korean people held Park Geun-hye government accountable for her wrongdoings. And the incident actually strengthened the rule of law in South Korea's democracy, not undermining it. Why? Because the scandal and the way Park Geun-hye governed, Park Geun-hye operated outside constitutional boundary. That's why she was impeached. Okay, so that was a big disgrace on the part of many Koreans because she operated outside the constitutional boundary of South Korea. But the way we got out of this scandal, okay, the way we removed Park Geun-hye from the Korean political scene, and the way we elected a new president, Moon Jae-in, was conducted within legal frame, within Korea's constitutional boundary. Sure, a lot of people went out on the streets and waged massive demonstration, what we call candlestick vigil. This demonstration went on for about months, several months. Really, millions of people poured into the streets and marched
into right in front of a blue house. But the demonstration was conducted in a peaceful manner. Not a single drop of blood was spilled during the massive demonstration. So the whole incident proves that Korea is governed by the rule of law, not merely a rule of the mass. And some people claim that, well, as far as impeachment is concerned, the Constitutional Court of South Korea has the final say, according to the Korean Constitution, according to the Korean law. That is the Constitutional Court that makes the final verdict. And that decision was unanimous. All these eight constitutional judges claimed that, made this decision that the President Park Geun-hye should be impeached, and that decision was supported by an overwhelming majority in the South Korea. So, what balance? I think there are more positives than negatives. And after Orrin said that, then I think the history will prove that this was the incident that will increase Korea's democratic credentials, add to Korea's democratic credentials. How democratic is South Korea? I did a bit of research, as I said, according to the Democracy Index, compiled by these economists, Korea ranks about 24 in this Democracy Index. I don't know what the difference is. Japan is I don't know. I think South Korea is more democratic than is Japan. And there is another democracy data set by Ted Berg. And also Korea scored a little bit low in this category of government accountability. But I think that this will improve after the impeachment of Park Geun-hye and the inauguration of Moon Jae-in. This is authority trends. Green line indicates surge of democracy, transition to democracy. Red line indicates breakdown of democracy, or surge of order. And there was a democratic trend four times over. There were surge of democracy. I don't know how familiar with you are with the Korean political history. When Jang Geun-hye, Prime Minister Jang Geun-hye, came to power in late 1950s by winning clear and fair and democratic election. At the time, South Korea was a parliamentary system, not a presidential system. There was a surge of democracy. There was a period of democratic transition, and then followed by democracy breakdown of democracy when Park Chung-hee, father of Park Geun-hye, came into power by this coup. South Korea's democracy score improved from 1961 until 1973 because there had been covered free presidential elections. And Park Geun-hye,
Changi won those Democratic election, first against the Rumba Song, and then against Kim Dae-jung. Kim Dae-jung, who later became president of South Korea. But in 1973, he amended the constitution, so-called Yuxin constitution, that virtually made his rule permanent. So there was this period of Korea's democratic potential populated in 1973. And then in 1986, former president, former president Jang Duman, not the president's strongman, declared there's going to be a freeze in presidential elections in South Korea. That was 1986. So that was the period of another second democratic transition in South Korea through history. And after that, South Korea's democratic support had steadily improved. I want to have this project of evaluating South Korea's democratic potential after the impeachment and after the inauguration of the new government. One of the essential conclusions of the democracy, as I said, I did a bit of research. Liberal democracy should guarantee civil liberty and human rights, should guarantee popular sovereignty. You know, sovereignty resides within the people, not within the ruler, right? And should guarantee freedom of expression. You should be able to hold democratic election on a regular basis. Rural growth should prevail, and there should have to be a separation of power. And multiplicity of political parties, I'm not so sure about that, but there's got to be a multiple. You know, we will not condone overly. In North Korea, there's only one party there. South Korea scores, you know, quite high in all these categories. Doesn't necessarily mean that South Korea is a perfect democracy. There's several challenges ahead of us. As I said, there is this, I think it is important to maintain this precarious balance between the rule of law and rule of people. I mean, of course, people should rule, that's for sure, but some people say that too much of evil power can undermine rule of law in South Korea's demands. We have to pay attention to that line of criticism, and we have to think more about the ways in which we can enhance the accountability of the government. I think we are moving in the right direction. And freedom of expression, I don't know, many people, outsiders, Westerners, are saying that there should be more of freedom of expression, media freedom. But I think we have plenty of media freedom and freedom of speech in South Korea. And I think the real problem is how we can deal with what they call crony cap policy. This unhealthy, improper relationship between the ruling elites and general. Korean deliveries. The incident proved that still the Korean ruling elites to collect bribe money from Jebol, from the Korean deliveries. They give these special treatments or special favor to these Jebols. Or Jebol give these bribe monies to elicit favorable treatment from the ruling elites. The practice has been going on for decades. So I think this really is a big challenge that we'll have to resolve in years to come. Second part, then what are the foreign policy challenges that the Moon Jae-in government is faced with? I think there are many problems, many foreign policy challenges that Moon Jae-in is faced with. Among those many challenges, two things stick out in my personal opinion. One is growing rivalry. I think this is the situation that the Philippines will also have to deal with, growing rivalry in the region. And second problem is North Korea's nuclear weapons and missiles program. Now, I think those are two more important foreign policy challenges that the Moon Jae-in government will have to deal with.
In Asia, in particularly Northeast Asia, although Cold War is a long, long history, but geopolitics is back. It's back in full force. And there has been shifting balance of power from the United States to China. And China's ascendance to superpower status in the region has created strategic uncertainty to many countries in the region, not just to South Korea, but to the Philippines as well. I'm not saying that China shouldn't be ascending to the superpower status. I think that they have all the rights in the world to become, say, the most powerful country in the world. I have no problem with that. But that, the status change has created this, uncertainties in this very, very volatile region of the world. Now President Xi Jinping claims that the relationship between the U.S. and China should be based on what he calls new type of great power relations. Excuse my Chinese pronunciation. And the U.S., for its own part, is saying that this was Obama, as a matter of fact, not Trump. Obama was saying that the U.S. would also have to reorganize foreign policy priorities. You'll have to pivot from Asia. Later, we change the language to rebalance Asia, rebalance stress. Why? Because Asia is the most important region in the world. In terms of the American national interests. So there is a growing, escalating rivalry between what they call G2, right? United States and China and the US. And it's not just the rivalry between the US and China, but also Japan's policy has become very militant in recent years. Abe made it clear that he'd like to amend Japan's peace constitution to obtain what they call collective self-defense rights, to make Japan a normal country, to make Japan the country they can fight war for. It's reminding South Korea of all these imperialistic policies that Japan implemented in the first half of the 20th century. And as you all know, American relationship with Russia has been under the strain. And Russia, I think, is doing their own version of people to Northeast Asia. They are now saying that we are also an important stakeholder country in Northeast Asia as well. Their foreign policy has been Eurocentric for a long period of time. But now they are saying that we are empowered to be reckoned with Northeast Asia's power struggle. We are an important stakeholder. People say this is a toxic situation that we have in Northeast Asia. Not just in Northeast Asia, in Asia as a whole. Why? Because countries in Northeast Asia, countries in Asia, are heavily interdependent in terms of economy. We are heavily interdependent. Economically, we are heavily interdependent, but in terms of security policies, we are very distant. I mean, it is no secret that we hate each other. And Japan hates Koreans. It's no secret. So this is paradoxical. We should be closer to each other. And particularly South Korea, I think it goes with the Philippines as well. Because we are located in this geopolitical position where we have to make a good relations with Chinese, not just with Americans. But with the growing and escalating rivalry between the two countries, we are constantly being asked by the Americans and by Chinese to keep aside. Are you with us or are you with them? When we were thinking about joining AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, Americans were saying to us that you should be joining AIIB. That's siding with Chinese. You should be joining them. And when we decided to deploy FAT, I don't know how familiar with FAT, that stands for Terminal High Altitude Area Defense System, to defend U.S. forces in North Korea against North Korean missile threat. nuclear weapons to defend South Korea from North Korea's increasing nuclear and missile capabilities. This belongs to our sovereign defense rights. And Chinese are saying that you should be deploying the system on the Korean soil, and there's going to be a punishment. Then there is a punishment. They started this retaliation measures, and Chinese stopped sending tourists to South Korea. You don't see any Chinese in Korea these days. So it's a good time to visit. If you're thinking about visiting Korea, this is a good time to visit South Korea, because you don't see many Chinese in Jeju Island. You know, 2 years ago, when I went to Jeju, you know, all I see was Chinese people, but you don't see Chinese people in Jeju. So this is the battle that we are faced with. Not just we, but the regime, but people is aware that this is the problem that we will have to deal with.
North Korea's nuclear and missile program. I'm not going to spend too much time about this. According to some statistics, now they have some 20 nuclear warheads, not just the plutonium bombs, but also uranium bombs. 20 nuclear warheads. And they succeeded in miniaturizing these nuclear warheads so that they can mount these nuclear warheads onto intercontinental ballistic missiles. They just tested about 3 weeks ago that ICBM that they fired, Hwasong 14, was ICBM. They succeeded in standardizing the production of these nuclear warheads. And now they have this ICBM capability with a range of reaching California shore of the United States. This is a game changer. This really is a game changer. And in 1913, they amended the constitution and promulgated a strategy known as Yongjin strategy. Yongjin is a Chinese word here. Yong means parallel, Jin means advancement. Yongjin, parallel advancement of economy and also nuclear and missile programs. So that is now constitutional duty of supreme leader of North Korea to work on not just on economy, but also on nuclear weapons and missiles. That became constitutional duty. That means that they are not going to trade away their nuclear weapons and their missiles capabilities for economic decisions or for any other diplomatic or political decisions.
So Moon Jae-in is saying that how can we deal with this you know, growing great rivalry in the region? How can we deal with this situation? And he's saying that we will have to invest in I won't have panel minutes.
We gotta give up more bilateralism a chance. That means we'll have to establish independent multilateral security institution in Northeast Asia region. Why? Because security especially is under-institutionalized in this region of the world. Okay, actually, this was originally Dr. Han's idea to deal with the Asian paradox. We will have to establish some kind of a multilateral security dialogue framework, a forum, if you will, to discuss host of security issues in the region. But you know, given the lack of trust amongst these member countries in Northeast Asia, it is impossible to address these hard security issues, like these intractable territorial disputes, or North Korea's nuclear weapons or missiles program. It's impossible. So the idea was that we will have to work on these soft security issues, less intractable security issues, such as how we can deal with environmental degradation, or we can together deal with these new types of attacks, disaster reliefs, how we can fight against pirates, so on and so forth. So by working on these easier issues, we might be able to cultivate the habit of cooperation.
by cooperating on these softer issues, we can generate trust. With this trust, we can move forward. We can move forward discussion of some of the hardest, if you think, more difficult situations in the region. That was Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative of African governments. And Moon Jae-in declared that he's not going to jettison this. Paris Plaza Alliance. Because I thought that he's going to jettison this idea because Moon Jae-in so far has been AEP or what actually. But like a couple of days ago, close foreign policy advisor claimed that by inaugurating what they call Northeast Asia Cross Community Plan, they'd like to expand and continue on acting as what we call Nazi, Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative. So he said that actually he will be strengthening Nazi, he will be expanding Nazi to embrace ASEAN countries, and also Australia and India. Traditionally, these progressive governments in South Korea, Moon Jae-in, the Indonesian government, their idea about multilateralism had been quite narrow. I mean, in terms of the membership, they wanted to sort of exclude Pacific players from this multilateral institution. You know, think about Moon Jae-in. He presented South Korea as a balanced country in Northeast Asian security affairs. And also top country in Northeast Asia's economic affairs. That wasn't really well received by Americans, understandably so, because, hey, Americans, you're not part of Asia. Kim Dae-jung also advocated this narrow vision of multilateralism or regionalism in the region, but it was quite surprising because Moon Jae-in is saying that he's all for this broader vision of multilateralism or regionalism. So it includes ASEAN has more say, of course, but the Pacific countries. Australia is, you know, is welcome. New Zealand is welcome. And Americans are very much welcome. And actually, we like this, this canvas, this membership. So it includes India as well. So that was quite a surprise for me. Well, how can we deal with the situation? Now, Moon Jae-in may be sure, because everybody thought that, not everybody, but many people thought that Moon Jae-in is going to be more North Korea friendly. He once said that during campaign period that he liked to visit North Korea first. He said that, oh, well, we should be able to say no to America. And then he came into the office and he said, well, I'd like to visit the U.S. first, and then he did. And I think he believes that still, although deep down in his heart, he's an anti-Americanist for sure. I don't know. But he knows. He knows that, you know, for South Korea's national interests, we will have to maintain very proactive and good relations with Americans. That is in our national interest. He realizes that still our relationship with the Americans is the cornerstone to preserve, protect, and promote South Korea's national interests. Upon that realization, he paid a visit to the United States at a summit meeting with Trump. It was a quite successful summit meeting, in my personal opinion. And he said that he's with Donald Trump, with the Americans, to stand firm against North Korea's threats. So sanctions will be there, and if necessary, we will be escalating sanctions machine against North Korea. And we will be augmenting our defense capability. That's what he said. We will have to augment our own deterrence, defense, and offense capability, such as, I don't know, I want to get into the details here. KMD stands for Korea's Missile Defense System, and Q-Chain, with which we can detect North Korea's imminent threats and then neutralize them before that threat becomes materialized. And Korea's massive, KMD stands for Korea's massive
punishment and retaliation. Our own capability.
This was quite surprising as well, because many people is talking about that it will be more accommodating with North Korea. North Korea is spreading interests.
And he said that we will have to work very close with the Americans for this, what they call extended shores. And the idea, the trick here is to make North Koreans think that their nuclear weapons are useless, because North Korea believes that there is an enormous strategic advantage that comes with the possession of nuclear weapons. They think they can dictate the terms of inter-Korean relations with nuclear weapons. Although I really don't think that they are going to use it against South Korea or Japan or America, they believe that they can dictate their diplomatic relations with South Korea, with Japan, with Americans, even with China as well. And he said, Moon Jae-in said, we will have to deny those strategic advantages that our friends do that come with the possession of nuclear weapons. I only have a couple more minutes, right? And also, Moon Jae-in highlighted the importance of maintaining pressures and escalating sanctions if necessary. We have to make sure that North Koreans feel that the international community as a whole is vehemently opposed against North Korea's nuclear and missiles programs. But at the same time, he says, at the same time, we will have to work on nuclear diplomacy in Korea. This is something that separates Moon Jae-in from Park Geun-hye, because Park Geun-hye has been all for sanctions. Park Geun-hye has been all for deterrence, defense, and offensive capability, augmenting these capabilities. But Moon Jae-in said that we have to talk to these guys. At least we should be able to manage the situation, although we cannot eliminate the problem altogether. By talking to North Koreans, maybe we can put a lid on their increasing capability. So that's what Moon Jae-in is suggesting. We gotta talk with these guys. Although North Koreans refuse to talk with South Koreans, they don't have to talk with them. Sideline Koreans. He proposed a two-stage solution to North Korea's nuclear problem, because to demand North Koreans to disarm nuclear weapons is almost impossible right now. So first objective is to freeze their capabilities. That's how we start the negotiation with North Korea. The immediate objective is to freeze their capability instead of disarming their nuclear weapons and missiles. That's got to be the ultimate objective. But in the meantime, the immediate objective should be to freeze those capabilities. I think our alliance partnership with the United States, Moon Jae-in realizes that this should be the cornerstone for South Korea's security interests. Okay, but there are many hurdles to cross. First, I think it is very important for South Korea and the U.S. to coordinate policies for North Korea, although both leaders, Trump and Moon Jae-in, agreed that given certain conditions, we can talk to North Koreans. It seems that Americans are raising the bar, while Moon Jae-in is lowering the bar. Moon Jae-in is really, he's very eager to talk. But Trump is like, but give it a shot, they won't talk. Okay, so it's difficult to coordinate these policies, although they agree on the principle. Trump has been asking us to pay for maintaining U.S. forces in South Korea. But we are paying like a half of the amount. The amount has been steadily increasing. Trump is saying that you gotta pay 100%. You gotta shoulder the burden of the entire burden of maintaining U.S. forces in South Korea. But this is, in my personal opinion, this is more of a cost sharing. If they ask us to pay 100%, we can pay 100%. All right. But the real challenge lies in
what I would call real burden sharing. Really, what are you going to do to cope with rising threat of China? Can South Korea shoulder more of a burden to cope with, to balance against rising threat in Northeast Asia? I mean, China's threat. That's real challenge, really. That's real meaning of burden sharing. And as I said, South Korea is positioned in this place in the region where we have to maintain good relations with Chinese as well. But if Americans ask us to do more to balance against Chinese, to make the U.S. great again, then this would be a real challenge. And, you know, Korea, U.S., free trade deal. Trump wants to renegotiate. Although it's going to be very difficult, but it's okay to make Americans great again. Trump is asking China, to reduce our exports to the U.S. and increase imports from. So I'm going to pause here, and do we have time for discussion? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.